In this video, we're going to be talking about residual current circuit breakers, RCCBs. These are also called GFCI or ground fault interrupters. They look like this when they're wired into a breaker box, but sometimes they're also integrated directly into a receptacle. Before we go into too much detail about how these particular circuit breakers work, let's review how ordinary circuit breakers work. Let's represent our mains by an AC voltage source and our load by a simple resistor. The circuit breaker always sits on the hot side of the circuit, and it trips anytime the current exceeds some preset value that's printed on the breaker. The purpose of an ordinary circuit breaker is to prevent fires. We don't want the current going through a wire to be so much that it could cause a wire to overheat and then start a fire. An ordinary circuit breaker, however, doesn't protect against shock. Let me show you why. Let's add a ground plane here to our diagram. Typically, in a residential or a commercial electrical installation, the neutral is tied to the ground at some point. The circuit breaker, however, doesn't know whether or not the current is returning to the source through the neutral or through the ground. Anytime an appliance has a metal case, it's good practice to provide an earth ground to that metal case and use a three-pronged outlet or a three-pronged plug. The reason for that is safety. If something were to go wrong, hypothetically, inside that appliance, and the casing would somehow be energized or short-circuited to the hot, then the current would flow down through the case and out through the earth ground. That would certainly be a lot better than not having the case connected to the earth ground, because then the entire case would just be a hot terminal waiting for somebody to come along and get shocked. Let's now assume that everything is working normally. We have a current going through our circuit breaker, over to our load, and then back through the neutral. This is how things ought to work. Imagine a person comes along and somehow makes contact with the hot side of that circuit, which in this case is not grounded. At typical line voltages, the person is going to get shocked. But how can the system guard against it? Well, one way to guard against it is to notice here that the current flowing out through the hot side through the circuit breaker is not equal to the current flowing back through the neutral. You see, the person has set up a ground fault. When somebody is getting shocked here, some of the current goes through the person and back through the earth ground rather than through the neutral. This brings us to our ground fault circuit breaker, or our residual current circuit breaker. This type of circuit breaker is connected to both the hot and the neutral side of the circuit. This circuit breaker is double wide, so to speak. We have a hot and a neutral on the top, and then we have a hot and a neutral down here at the bottom. Power flows in and the power flows out. What this device does is it monitors the amount of current going through the hot side and compares it to the amount of current coming back through the neutral. If the two differ by a preset amount, which is printed on the side of the circuit breaker, then it'll trip and break both the neutral and the hot connections simultaneously. Let's see how it would work in the case of a shock. Let's again assume that somehow a person comes along and manages to avoid a grounded case and make contact with the hot side of this circuit by accident. Initially, we have equal amounts of current going out through the hot and back through the neutral. But when the person makes contact with the hot, then we're going to have unequal amounts of current going out through the hot and coming back through the neutral. That will cause the ground fault circuit breaker to trip. Normally, these circuit breakers are designed to trip off at about a 30 milliamp difference between hot and neutral. 30 milliamps is the kind of current that starts to present a serious shock hazard to humans. This particular circuit breaker, though, is especially sensitive. It trips off at 10 milliamps. In a minute, we're going to go over to the bench and simulate one of these fault conditions. Let me draw out first what I intend to do, and then we'll go and test it. We'll be plugging our circuit breaker into the wall and giving it 230 volts. I'll be attaching a 10 kilo-ohm load resistor to our circuit breaker. That should draw about 23 milliamps from the wall. We need to make sure that our resistor can handle that much current draw, so anything more than about 5 watts should be fine. We won't be using the third prong of the plug in this particular simulation of a fault condition, but we know that somewhere back in the electrical circuitry of the building, the neutral is tied to the ground. To simulate a fault condition, I'm going to hook a second resistor from the hot side after the switch to ground or to neutral. Without that resistor in place, the current coming out through the hot side and going back through the neutral side would be equal. However, with that fault resistor in place, some of the current that flows out through the hot side through the switch will not be flowing back through the neutral. If we use a large resistor, then that fault current will be very low and the circuit breaker won't trip. But if I use a lower value for the fault resistor, then we should be able to make this circuit breaker trip. Let's go over to the bench now and try out this little experiment and see if we can get this ground fault circuit breaker to trip. This circuit breaker can detect ground faults, and this particular model can detect ground faults exceeding 10 milliamps. Up here on the input side, we have the hot that's going to come in from the mains on the right, and then neutral is coming in on the left. You can see here that it's labeled N, and N stands for neutral. It's important to keep hot where it belongs and neutral where it belongs. Over here on the output side, we have a load, which in this case is a 10 kilo ohm load. That should draw 23 milliamps from the mains, and we have it hooked in series here with an ammeter that will measure that current. Let's go ahead and turn it on and measure the actual current that's flowing. Before I do that, however, I want to point out that this is potentially a dangerous situation here, so we need to be very careful. The ammeter here has a 400 milliamp fuse in it, so we do have our load fused. Let's go ahead and turn it on and see how much current this draws. As we can see, our 10 kilo ohm load is drawing about 23 milliamps of current. Nobody's getting shocked. The current going out through the hot side should be equal to the current coming back through the breaker on the neutral side. That way it doesn't trip. What I'd now like to do is simulate somebody getting shocked. And when I set up simulations of a fault condition, I'm keeping in mind the Chernobyl nuclear accident where they were simulating a fault condition and accidentally caused a nuclear meltdown. So we need to be really careful here. What I'm going to do is attach a resistor to the load, but I'm going to bypass the circuit breaker. This should simulate somebody getting shocked. This is a 47 kilo ohm resistor, so it should draw about 5 milliamps. Normally, I would want to hook this resistor down here to this neutral so that the current would go back through the meter. But if somebody is getting shocked, the current passing through their body would go to ground rather than going through the meter. So we're going to simulate that by hooking the other side of the resistor up to the neutral on the top. Since only 5 milliamps is going to be flowing through this fault condition, it shouldn't be enough current to cause the meter to trip. Let's turn it on and check. We still have around 23 milliamps flowing through our load, but we also have 5 milliamps flowing through this fault condition. It's not enough to cause the circuit breaker to trip, but if I were to lower down this resistance such that the current flowing through the fault is more than 10 milliamps, then it should cause this circuit breaker to trip. We're going to do that next. I'll be replacing the 47 kilo ohm resistor with a 10 kilo ohm resistor. And we already know that a 10 kilo ohm resistor should draw 23 milliamps. That's enough to cause this circuit breaker to trip if it works like it's designed. I'm going to go ahead and turn it back on now without the resistor in the loop. We can imagine somebody getting shocked as I make this final connection, which should cause 23 milliamps to flow through the fault. We can see that the circuit breaker works exactly as it was designed to. I hope you can see now how these ground fault circuit breakers work. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.